call a meeting of the Higher Education and Career Readiness Policy and Finance Committee to order. We do have a quorum. And at this point, I'd like to ask for a motion to approve the minutes from our January 18th meeting.
Mr. Chair, I move the minutes.
Representative Christensen moves the minutes. Any questions? Not all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes approved. Today, we welcome the university. Glad you're here, and I believe there are some regents in the audience and maybe some other guests, too. So welcome to everybody, and we look forward to a very informational almost 2 hours.
Very good, Chair Nornes, members of the committee. Thank you for having us. We are an educational institution, and we're here to talk about what we do in answer to your questions.
I would just like to ask the members of the committee that if we can allow the presentation before we ask questions, that would probably be helpful.
So, very good.
President Kaler, welcome, and you can proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I am Eric Kaler, president of the University of Minnesota, and I'm joined this afternoon by several people, including Regents Tom Anderson, Michael Hsu, Dave McMillan, Tom Devine, and Darren Rocha. And I hope I've got all of them. You don't want to miss a regent. We appreciate the opportunity to share with you the statewide impact of the University of Minnesota and our accountability to our students, their families, to the citizens of Minnesota, and to you here at the legislature. Thank you, too, for inviting us to demonstrate to you the transparency in our budgeting process. Joining me today at the table will be our provost, Karen Hansen, Senior Vice President for Finance and Operations, Brian Burnett, and our Budget Director, Julie Tonneson. We are ready to answer all of your questions about our budgeting process. Our biennial budget request reflects this budget process, so we appreciate the opportunity to give each of you this information today. And with this foundation, I hope you can support the request. You will see that our budget and our legislative budget request, which has been advanced by the Board of Regents, is driven by the needs of our students. Mr. Chair, I'm in my sixth year as president, and so my sixth legislative session with you. I'm starting to feel like a veteran of this remarkable partnership between this committee, the legislature, our governor, and the university, and I believe that is a strong, productive, and honest partnership. I understand fully that we must be clear in our articulation to you how we've arrived at our budget decisions, and I know it's your job to examine, question, and look at the details. We welcome that. Just like our state's budget, the university's budget is not simply a collection of numbers, charts, or spreadsheets. It is rather a reflection of our values, our priorities, and the needs of our students, faculty, and staff, and indeed the needs of all of the people of the state of Minnesota. My vision for the future is of an excellent and affordable University of Minnesota, and one that serves the people of Minnesota while preparing the next generation of leaders for our state. That's reflected in our budget, in the decisions we make to develop our budget, and in the initiatives and proposals we bring to you. At its core, my vision is also guided by the university's longstanding mission. And I want to emphasize a key section of the last clause, that we are driven to apply the knowledge we create and that our students gain for the benefit of the people of the state. I'm committed to a strong University of Minnesota system that includes five excellent and distinct campuses in Crookston, Duluth, Morris, Rochester, and the Twin Cities. We are also proud to serve some of Minnesota's best and brightest students. More than 70% of our students system-wide graduated from Minnesota high schools. But we are also a system that is global in nature, with students from more than 135 nations, and more importantly, with thousands of Minnesota's young people studying abroad so that they're ready for careers in Minnesota's global businesses, from those that are local and growing to our many Fortune 500s. We offer extraordinary breadth and depth to serve our students on all five of our campuses, from agriculture and food business management to the theater arts, from geological sciences to medicine, and from early childhood education to neuroscience. My vision includes a strong public engagement component in which we partner with you and with communities across the state to solve some of Minnesota's grand challenges, from helping to cure and treat cancer to ensuring all our citizens have clean water. to increasing the production of healthy food in greater Minnesota, to aiding the innovations in mining, and to closing the educational achievement gaps that exist in just about every community in our state. To achieve that vision, we must remain one of the nation's leading land-grant public research universities because we help to fuel Minnesota's economy, to drive Minnesota's innovation culture, and to serve as a partner with you in tackling some of the state's most pressing issues. By every measure, we are a top 10 university among our peers, and we are the eighth most active public research university in the nation, bringing in hundreds of millions of dollars in federal and private industry investment to our state. The state of Minnesota is the 21st most populous state in the United States, and yet we're number 8 in research. And because of our historic partnership, we can say that we fight above our weight. But I didn't get us here. It was our brilliant faculty and decades of strong support from your predecessors to seed innovation who did. To remain this excellent, we must be a well-run organization that is an exceptional steward of our students' tuition dollars and the taxpayers' dollars provided with your support. And I believe our record of operational excellence, which we will share with you over the past 5 years, shows we have been. My vision for CZ University that continues to stand for affordable excellence, providing access to the most qualified young people in our state, no matter what their family backgrounds or economic standing. And so it's my vision that the University of Minnesota fulfills its mission as the state's only land-grant institution, developing the next increasingly diverse generation of leaders, of career-ready employees, of lifelong learners, and of truly engaged citizens, perhaps some who will one day be a member of this committee. I trust you will see our presentation today in the context of this vision and also in the spirit of transparency that we come here today. Mr. Chair, before going further, let me first turn briefly to a topic that's been in the statewide conversation over the past weeks, and that's athletics on our Twin Cities campus, particularly football. Under the leadership of our new athletics director, Mark Coyle, we are undergoing a change in the culture in our football program. Big-time college sports is a major component of a large state university like ours on the Twin Cities campus with an athletics budget of $105 million. Gopher Athletics covers its budget with the revenues it earns from ticket sales, sponsorships, and media contracts, with a large chunk of that coming because of our membership in one of the premier and most popular conferences in the nation, the Big Ten. As to our recent football coaching transition, I want to assure you that no state or tuition dollars will be used to cover the cost of the buyouts of our former staff or any costs related to the transition. There are a number of payments made annually between the university and Gopher Athletics. We can reconcile those numbers for you, but very briefly, the university allocates $7 million to the athletics program. We charge them $4 million for various services, including things like debt service, reflecting a net subsidy of the athletics department of about $3 million. That's consistent with the amount of money that the state provided to the university for many years as a way to account for Title IX expenditures, and which was folded into the general allocation to the university some years ago. However, all of our student athletes also pay tuition, and if you count the net flow of tuition from those student athletes, our athletics department makes a net positive contribution to the university's budget of about $9 million. Mr. Chair, members of this committee, I have great confidence in our athletics director, Mark Coyle, and I'm excited about the future of athletics as we lead with our values and win competitions the right way in all 25 of our sports. Now, here's our plan for this presentation. Provost Hansen will share with you an overview of our academics, our university system with campuses, extension, research centers, and healthcare affiliations just about everywhere, and she'll highlight our research enterprise. In short, she will report on the deep impact of the university on our state. And then Senior Vice President Burnett and Budget Director Tonneson will explain how our budget works and how we make decisions to develop our budget. You should have already received a copy of our fiscal year 2017 budget, as well as information on tuition. Although we will not get into the details of those documents today, I hope they are helpful in better understanding the decisions we have made. Finally, after Ms. Tonneson finishes, I will describe how we've demonstrated our accountability to the Board of Regents, you, the public, and our students and their families. Thank you again for this opportunity. I look forward to a robust conversation, and I will now turn this over to Provost Hansen.
Thank you.
Welcome to the committee. If you'd identify yourself for the record and then proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. I'm Karen Hansen, Executive Vice President and Provost of the University of Minnesota. I'm the Chief Academic Officer of the university. As you probably know, the colleges and schools of the university are led by deans. And in turn, the deans of the colleges and schools on the Twin Cities campus report to me, as do the deans of graduate and undergraduate education, the vice provost for student affairs, and our offices of public engagement and international programs and partnerships. But all academic initiatives, such as our campus strategic plan, emanate from our faculty, responding to student needs and the changing landscape of discovery and innovation. And these initiatives are then managed by my office in close partnership with the academic units. If I may, let me briefly sketch the basics of our academic operation, a sort of academic outline of the University of Minnesota. First, the University of Minnesota is the state's only comprehensive land-grant public research university, older than the state itself, having been born in 1851. And we're very proud of the impact we have statewide in all 87 counties. With and through our five campuses, the presence in all of Minnesota's counties of our powerful extension network of experts, the work of our research and outreach centers, and our 1,700 healthcare affiliations across Minnesota. Very briefly, let me tell you first about the five distinctive campuses that make up our diverse university, which is known regionally, nationally, and internationally for its extraordinary depth and breadth, as well as its quality. Of course, our largest campus is here in the Twin Cities, with students and facilities in both Minneapolis and St. Paul. It's one of only five campuses in the United States with schools of law, medicine, agriculture, engineering, veterinary medicine, and business congregated on one campus. The University of Minnesota Crookston is known for its focus on experiential learning, especially in agricultural education, and it's also one of the nation's pioneers of high-quality online and distance education. The University of Minnesota Duluth, or UMD, is our highly ranked regional research university with 11,000 students, a full range of majors, and many professional programs, and a global reputation for freshwater research. It's a generator of well-prepared employees, particularly for Northeast Minnesota's economy. The University of Minnesota Morris is our nationally ranked undergraduate-focused liberal arts campus with a deep and distinctive commitment to environmental sustainability and a long history of educating the state's Native American population. It is, in fact, one of the very few public liberal arts colleges in the nation, and we're very proud of that. And the University of Minnesota Rochester is our newest campus. It has an innovative curriculum and facilities that leverage Rochester community assets, such as the Mayo Clinic, to educate health science professionals and prepare them for careers. This map, this image, is definitely worth a thousand words. It illustrates the more than 1,000 state touch points the University of Minnesota has, connecting to your constituents. Through our academic health center, including our medical school and pharmacy programs in both Duluth and the Twin Cities, we have, as I said, about 1,700 healthcare affiliations around the state. We have research and outreach centers and laboratories from North Minneapolis to Willmar to Lake Itasca. We have 15 regional extension offices and our extension with its remarkable range of community engagement, from family services to 4-H, to its traditional agricultural consulting, to its work focused on tourism and natural resources. Extension, in fact, works with Minnesotans in all 87 counties. So, we're big, we're busy, and we're welcoming. We're the state's sixth largest employer. It takes millions of square feet of space for our students, faculty, and staff to learn, live, and work. We welcome and serve thousands of Minnesota high school students on our campuses across the state through post-secondary enrollment options while they're in high school. And we treat and cure thousands of large and small animals every year at our veterinary clinic. We affect many lives, young and old, human and dear to human animals, every day. First and foremost, we affect the lives of our students and their families. World-class education is our primary responsibility, and it's what drives our values, our pedagogy, and our commitment to you and to the citizens of the state. Across our system, on those five campuses, we educate more than 67,000 students. More than 70% of the incoming freshman students across our system are, as President Kaler said, Minnesota young people. And that percentage, the percentage of students from Minnesota, grows in our total undergraduate student body as we look at our sophomore, junior, and senior classes, because we accept many transfer students, most of them coming from Minnesota State University institutions. This is a terrific option for many Minnesota students, and it ensures a pathway to the university for all Minnesotans. One of our clearest aims is to serve all of our students across all of our system by providing them with the classes they want and need, by offering them effective counseling and advising to ensure their progress, and by helping to ensure that if they apply themselves, they'll earn their degrees in 4 years. Graduating in 4 years allows them to move more quickly into Minnesota's workforce and civic life. It saves tuition for our students and families, and we know how important that is. Our graduation rates are, as a general rule, steadily and markedly improving across our system. A key to improving those 4 and 6 year rates is ensuring that students who are admitted to the U can succeed. The retention rates noted in this slide demonstrate that our enrollment management approach, our first year orientation programs, our advising, and our student support are working. It's a simple fact: if a student doesn't return for her second year, she can't graduate in 4. We work hard to make our campuses places where our students want to return, places where they'll succeed in their studies and graduate. Let me turn now to an aspect of the University of Minnesota that distinguishes us from all other higher education institutions in the state: our research enterprise. As President Kaler noted earlier, we're the 8th most active public research university in the nation, a distinction which is not just a point of pride, but which is a clear marker of the fact that we're the center for innovation and discovery, for cures, treatments, and inventions for our state. It's not just the extraordinary number of knowledge innovations or new companies that have blossomed from our faculty's research. It's the impact of the research for the people of Minnesota and, frankly, the nation and world. Historically, the medical device industry in our state was born with the pacemaker at the U. Transplant medicine got its start at the U. Taconite was developed at the U. Today, we're leaders in finding cures and treatments for Alzheimer's, diabetes, rare childhood skin diseases, for developing sustainable plastics, food safety tests and tools, vaccines for livestock, educational software. Such a diversity of research foci requires many partnerships, and we pride ourselves on being good partners with business, industry, public agencies, and private donors. Here you can see the sources of support for the work of our faculty and researchers. By the way, our research partnership with you, known as MnDrive, has been a spectacular success. In the first round of MnDrive, which stands for Minnesota's Discovery Research and Innovation Economy, we've seen the emergence of 184 disclosures for new inventions. MnDrive has leveraged about $176 million in external funding from more than 300 partners. When we present our biannual budget request to you in the weeks to come, we'll be telling you more about the value of this investment by the state. But for now, let me just say we're very proud of the success of MnDrive, and we're eager to build on that partnership with you. Here you can see the breadth of all of our startup companies and the momentum of our technology transfer efforts, with more and more startups launching every year, fueling the state's economy. And this leads to the university's economic impact. Here are impact data generated in 2011, but still basically valid and appropriately illustrative. The key data point is this: for every dollar you invest in the U, you'll see a rate of return 13-fold, a remarkable rate of return for any investment. In closing, Mr. Chair and members of the committee, When it comes to our academics, our research, and our impact on every community in our state, the University of Minnesota is on an indisputably upward trajectory. We're very grateful for the support and investment this legislature and governor have made to keep the university strong, and we look forward to working with you in the weeks and months ahead. With that, I'd like to turn this over to our Senior Vice President for Finance and Operations, Brian Burnett, who will discuss our budget.
Mr. Burnett, welcome to the committee. Is this your first time here in front of this fabulous committee?
Yes, first time.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon, members of the committee. I am Brian Burnett. I'm the Senior Vice President for Finance and Operations, and I'm very pleased to be here on behalf of the university. And as President Kaler and Provost Hansen noted, Julie Tonneson, a longtime budget director for the university, is here joining me, and we'll walk you through the next section of slides.
Okay, go ahead.
So the operating budget for the university is $3.6 billion, but it really breaks into two important points. And this slide points out that we have about $575 million we expect in the current year of those research awards or sponsored programs will be expended by our faculty and our researchers across the entire enterprise. The remaining $3 billion is made up of a number of sources that come up in this next slide. And this slide shows you the very large number of revenue sources for the university, but some of which are very important to us. Of course, the tuition, but also the state support is extremely important to a research university like the University of Minnesota. You can also see the pie chart where we get overhead recoveries known as ICR from our research awards. We also run a number of auxiliary enterprises, your dormitories, your bookstores that support the academic mission of the campuses. So this is the $3.6 billion in various different pie charts that we can walk through today. This next chart shows, Provost Hansen's point, that our deans, our colleges, they manage very different financial enterprises. And across the bottom, you can see the breadth and the scope of the medical school and what it brings in terms of research to the university, what it brings in largely that NIH funding that you saw in the earlier chart. But you can also see that the mix of revenues for each of our colleges and our system campuses is quite different. And it's a very complicated graph, but it tries to show you the scale of some of our colleges and how large they are, both in terms of the university as an enterprise, but also impact economically to the state of Minnesota. Julie?
And let me just add here, we will be talking more about process and how we make decisions around how some of these revenues flow within the institution later in the presentation. We won't spend a lot of time here on that right now. But these units that are represented here are our major academic units, as we refer to them. It's the Twin Cities Colleges and the system campuses, along with Extension and the Experiment Station. And these are the units that we budget around. So we actually develop our annual budget at this level, in addition to each of our major support units, and then we add it all up or sum it all up at a university level. So this is where, so to speak, the action takes place, and we will talk more about that.
Ms. Tonneson, I'd like to have you just introduce yourself for the record, to make it official.
Sure, sorry. Right. My name is Julie Tonneson. I am the Associate Vice President for Budget and Finance and the Budget Director.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt, but that's...
No, that's okay. That's all right. So I want to turn first to take a look at some of the ways we track expenditures. Before we get into process, we will talk more about expenditures and revenues. And we actually track our expenditures in two different ways in the ledger. This is one view of that. This is non-sponsored funds only. So as Senior Vice President Burnett mentioned, we get sponsored funds specifically for dedicated research projects. They are multi-year, they are very restricted, they are not included in this view of the university's budget. That's why it's $3.1 billion here in expenditures for the current year. In an object of expenditure view, you can see that we are a people place. Over 60% of our spending is done on salaries and fringes. In the 20 plus years I've been at the university, that percentage has ranged in the 60 to 65% the entire time. The other pieces of the pie have been relatively stable, but student aid, I would say, has grown a little bit over time, as well as some of the supplies and services expenses and the facility expenses that are sprinkled in here. A second way that we track expenditures, it's the exact same $3.1 million, but we are able to track it by what we call function codes. Each major university, well, each university that receives federal funding has to report different pieces of data and information into what's called IPEDS. It stands for Integrated Post-Secondary Education Data System, which is maintained by the National Center for Education Statistics. And that organization has defined functions at a university that you see here. They provide the definitions, and it's up to all of the people at the university to code our spending in accordance with those definitions. And the result you see here is what we spend, again, non-sponsored, on instruction, research, public service, academic support, student services, and so forth. This does not include the $575 million of sponsored research spending that we spoke about earlier. That would obviously shift some of these percentages if you put it in here. If that was all research, the research portion of the pie would grow to almost 25%.
Can I interrupt for just one more moment? I'm being told that your voice is not being picked up too well, so if you could move closer to one of the microphones, it would be very helpful. We should have longer microphones, but...
That's okay.
All right.
Is that better?
That'll be much better. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Next, we want to turn to more details related to the trends in some of our revenues.
So this chart is a 20-year chart, and it shows back in 1997 that the state of Minnesota was allocating about 5% of its general fund budget to the University of Minnesota. Today, that's more like 3%, and there's a variety of reasons for that, including pressures on the budget with respect to Medicaid and transportation and other things. But as a share of the state budget, the University of Minnesota continues to be on a downward trajectory over the last 20 years as a share of the state's budget.
Focusing specifically on our appropriation over time, you can see from this chart it shows our general fund support only from 2008 to 2019, if our full request was funded through 2019. From the low point in FY12 and FY13 to today, FY17, the general fund appropriation has increased $80.9 million, unadjusted for inflation. If our full request were funded through FY19, however, it would still be 5.2% less than the high point of 2008 in terms of buying power. So adjusted for inflation, we would be 5.2% less than in 2008. Since 2001, the trend in state funding has fluctuated, and in unadjusted dollars is about $37 million higher today, while tuition has grown steadily up and through FY12, surpassing the state appropriation in FY10, and it has remained relatively flat in the last 5 years. This chart represents revenue, so it's important to understand that this is a result of rate changes as well as changes in volume or enrollment. So even if we didn't increase rates, there would be some increase in revenue. Tuition increases have been necessary in combination with internal reallocation, which we will talk about in some upcoming slides, to address our cost increases, which happen to go up every year, and to maintain excellence in program and activities throughout.
Taken together, this next slide shows from 1989 to 2017, really the mix of funds powering the University of Minnesota has quite dramatically changed. The blue bar is the state appropriation as a percentage of the university's budget was nearing 40% in 1989, and tuition was 12%. You can see that those have converged, if not flipped, as you head into 2017, where all other revenues of the university, all those other diversifying revenues, have grown over time to become around almost 60% of the total budget of the university. So we continue to look for ways to diversify revenue to support the mission of the U, but there's been a tremendous change in those underlying operation and maintenance funds between the tuition and state support.
for more detail on that red bar on tuition. For FY17, this chart shows the distribution of that revenue by group. The largest portion, or 34% of our tuition revenue this year, will come from Twin Cities undergraduates paying the resident rate, followed at 21.5% from Twin Cities graduate students. And you can see that Duluth professional students and the Twin Cities undergraduate non-resident, non-reciprocity student groups each make up a similar piece of the pie in the $110 to $120 million range and roughly 13 to 14%. Some basic principles we have adopted in setting tuition are here. We have a very student-centered process for deciding on our tuition rates. But for some structure, we have one undergraduate rate for all colleges on the Twin Cities campus, except the Carlson School of Management, which has a $1,000 annual surcharge. We have one undergraduate rate that is shared for the Duluth, Morris, and Rochester campuses, and one rate for the Crookston campus. And for each of these, there is a credit band above which that allows for additional course credits above 13 at no additional charge. These practices encourage full-time enrollment and timely graduation and remove incentives with regard to academic progress or major choice. For the graduate and professional side, tuition rates are set based on market considerations, and they do differ by program. Within this structure, tuition rates are set each year after considering a variety of factors, including the availability of student aid, the availability of alternative revenue sources, our ability to internally reallocate funds to higher from lower to higher priorities, and our position in and against our various peers by campus or market considerations. For FY17, our major rates are displayed here. You can see the undergraduate resident and non-resident rates for each of our campuses, the graduate general program rate, and then each of our first professional programs. For the Twin Cities campus, the non-resident rate exceeds the resident rate for undergraduates by $10,000. We will talk more about that in an upcoming slide as well. For the last 5 years, the trajectory on the resident undergraduate rate has clearly been lower.
This chart shows that over the last 5 years, the average annual increase on the Twin Cities campus for undergraduate in-state students has increased at 1%. And for the system campuses, less than 0.5%. What this shows is that I think that the university has shown extreme restraint in trying to keep tuition affordable for Minnesota residents who attend all five of our campuses.
In addition to the tuition, students are assessed various fees depending on their campus, college, program, and individual courses that they take. There are two primary types of fees outside of room and board. The first is a category in which the students recommend to assess themselves. This is called student services fees. We have a separate annual process in which student-focused departments and groups propose and request fee revenue, and a student majority committee makes recommendations to leadership on which ones should go forward. A second group of fees has actually several different components. There are a variety of administrative fees based on individual enrollment or situation, such as late payment fees. We have course fees that cover things like transportation for field trips, consumable materials, as well as the purchase of special talent for courses. And we have academic fees in some of our colleges and campuses that pay specifically for student services, such as career services, advising, access to technology, computer rooms, and that type of thing. Tuition plus these fees are two components of what is known as the full cost of attendance, partial, which is shown here for a comparison.
And as Julie noted, one of the things we look at is our competitiveness with our peers. And you can see through this chart that in total cost of attendance, we're right in the middle of the Big Ten conference in the Midwest and some on the East Coast. But we generally do look at this, and this is tuition and fees, and what's in total cost of attendance are things like transportation, health care, housing, those types of things. So you look at the entire package for a student to attend our university, and we look to be in the middle of the Big Ten in this, and it's another factor we look at when setting tuition. The other piece to look at on slide 31 is our non-resident tuition. And it's very common across the United States for public universities to use subsidies from non-resident students to help pay for the tuition costs and operational costs for resident students. Here you can see that the University of Minnesota is actually towards the bottom end of the Big Ten, and it's something we're paying close attention to, and we're going to continue to look at whether our market can move up and bring some additional revenue, which would help fund the university and relieve any need or some of the need for in-state tuition increases if we can maintain that market, both for out-of-state students that are paying full price and for international students. But it's something you have to be very careful about as you work to attract the classes that come to the university from outside the state. I think the other piece to know, as Julie noted earlier, a big piece of the budget that's grown over the last several years is financial support from the institution to our students. And back to President Kaler's point about being affordable and being an excellent choice for Minnesota students, you can see that gift aid and total aid and all the way across to the right, $200 million working with our donors to help support our students is not a small investment for us. $19 million worth of waivers. Employment is a very good way for students to help pay for school at about $34 million. And then last but not, you know, certainly something that we all want to pay attention to, loans become part of it for some of our students.
And let me just add here that this the state grant program that is managed by the Office of Higher Education provides funding to the students at the University of Minnesota as well. That would be in the top line. That's part of the $200 million. The university also funds a need-based aid program called the Promise Program that provides aid to students from families with adjusted gross income up to $120,000, and that is also in that top line. The loan category here is obviously the largest, but it has been declining. As this chart from an Office of Higher Education 2015 survey shows, the median debt for those with a bachelor's degree decreased in the 2012 to 2015 time frame by $722, or about 3% for University of Minnesota students. It also decreased for those students in private institutions and increased only slightly for students in state universities. And not an insignificant number of university students actually graduate without any debt, as you can see here.
So this shows by campus the number of students who graduate without debt, and it is not an insignificant piece. I think it gets lost up in the discourse that you assume everyone graduates from the universities with debt in today's time, and it's just not the case. So this is something we track and look carefully at, but digging beneath that a little bit, this is just the Twin Cities campus, bachelor's degree recipients that graduated, and this line chart shows on the left about 3,000 students with no debt, and then it shows the various numbers of students in different debt categories, and it's clearly on the left side of the graph that the notion that there's a lot of students graduating with thousands and thousands and thousands of part of debt is a very small number of those that come through our doors and graduate. You can see this chart shows you by grouping how many students graduate with that amount of debt in that year on the Twin Cities campus.
Moving away a little bit from actual revenue, one budget tool we have implemented each year to help hold down costs for students is internal reallocation. We consider internal reallocation a resource in the budget process. When we make deliberate decisions to eliminate a cost that either eliminates the need for revenue or frees up an existing revenue to pay for cost increases and for new initiatives. One way to demonstrate the importance of this tool is shown here. It shows the last 6 years and what we have included in our approved budget for planned internal reallocations. You can see it was $40.5 million, a significant amount in FY12, and the most recent year was $22.8 million. We tried to take 1 year off, 2013. We didn't quite make it. We did reallocation that year as well. And what it shows next to that is an equivalency in terms of what would have been necessary in a tuition rate increase on undergraduate students or in an increase in state appropriation to give you some indication of the equivalency of that reallocation. So for example, in 2017, that $22.8 million of internal expenditure reductions we implemented, we would have, rather than do that, we could have increased tuition 5.1%, or an average of $615 per student, or it would have required a 3.5% increase in our state appropriation. In recent years, the reallocations have really focused on administrative areas. President Kaler, prior to FY14, implemented a plan to reduce our administrative costs by $90 million over 6 years. The first 3 years of that, FY14 through FY16, have been completed, and we have implemented $53 million in reductions in administrative categories. How that looks within the institution, 71% of that has been done through elimination of positions. You can see there approximately 395 positions have been eliminated, and 29% has been done through reductions in more general operating costs, such as supplies, facility costs, travel, and so forth. Another way to describe it is in terms of where it's happened. 70% of the reductions have been in our academic units, those that were on that initial chart. An additional 30% have been done in support units. And just to point out some relative magnitude here, the ratio in terms of base budget would be 80% of our base budget is in academic units, 20% in support. So our support units are taking a bigger share of these internal reductions to administrative costs. That's the first 3 years. We have provided a complete itemized list of these reductions for FY14 and FY16 as required by law to the state. And then we have 3 years left. So this current year we're in, FY17, we have planned another $15 million of internal reductions to administrative costs. And for FY18 and 19, that leaves $22 million left. These are done both through large-scale restructuring, program and service eliminations, as well as through many, many small-scale consolidations and efficiencies throughout the institution. I want to pivot now to talk about more about our budget development process, including our decision-making process and how we make it all come together. First, it's important to restate something we mentioned earlier, or to emphasize how we think about and plan around our different revenue sources in the budget process. Our two largest discretionary unrestricted revenue sources are tuition and our O&M state appropriation. And we think about them in budgeting as one combined source. Together, they support all of the direct operations, the instructional costs, the research infrastructure costs, the public service costs, as well as all the support, the facility costs, the compliance costs, the equipment, supplies, everything else in running the institution. It's extremely important that we have the degrees of freedom in those unrestricted funds in order to make it all work most effectively and efficiently. And the budget process, as a result, really focuses on those two funds. So we'll talk more about that. In the other non-sponsored fund category, that's where you see the sales income, the grant income, the endowment earnings and gifts and those types of things. That's generated by activity in the departments, and it varies across units and it varies across departments. And our expectation in the budget process is that that revenue covers the costs associated with all those activities and in fact grows some in order to help grow programming in those areas. But we monitor that revenue, we forecast it, we work with the units on it, but the budget process is really focused on our discretionary tuition and O&M appropriation. I want to spend just a minute talking about the timeline and an important aspect of that timeline, which is in sort of the lime green box in the upper left-hand corner here. At the beginning of a biennial cycle, so in the summer of an even-numbered year, before we submit our biennial request to the state of Minnesota, we go through a planning exercise that looks at our incremental variables in the budget, and we decide how we're going to move forward in planning to balance that budget. So we will make decisions in that time frame on how much new investment we want to make over the next year or two, how much internal reallocation we want to do, what would we like to do or need to do in terms of tuition revenue increases coupled with the state appropriation request, how much would we like to pay in terms of an increase in salary for our employees, how much our facility costs, and so forth. We look at the 30,000-foot large variables in the budget, and on an incremental basis, we balance the budget at that point as a plan. Then we go through the process. The green boxes represent the request to the state of Minnesota for our appropriation. And you can see that starts in the summer and actually goes all the way, as you're familiar, through the end of May or early June. The blue boxes represent our annual budget process, which in the first year, actually the last year of the biennium, the first year of the cycle, runs simultaneously with our request. So while we have a request into the state of Minnesota right now and are tracking that through this process, we are also internally in the university going through a process of decision making on next year's budget, which will start July 1st. We work with support units first in the fall. We work with academic units in the spring. The second year of the biennium, we know our appropriation, but the annual budget continues. We do an annual budget internally within the university every year. The budget framework, that lime green box, is actually very important because those variables and our assumptions in that planning process really drive the whole process. It's what we build our budget instructions around to our units and what we talk to them about during the process. The president and his leadership team determine those assumptions on an annual incremental basis. The changes in what you see here, tuition, state appropriation, planned reallocation, compensation, other costs, and so forth. A second important piece to understand in our budget process is actually the budget model we use. I could go into extreme detail on this, but I will spare you that. This could take hours to explain. But in very simple terms, there's a picture here of what we call our budget model. We do responsibility center management budgeting at the university, which means we attribute revenues and costs to the units that do the mission, those academic units that were on that first colorful chart. We do this in order to incent behavior and to improve transparency in decision making. So in our model, for example, the tuition is attributed 100% in the left box there to the academic units that generate it. It does not come centrally. It goes 75% to the unit that does the instruction and 25% to the unit of enrollment. Each of the other revenues you see in that box go directly to those academic units based on what their activities that generate it. The allocated state appropriation in the lower left, we make a decision each year. It is not formula driven at the university. We make a conscious decision on a base plus minus process, much like the state decides how to fund its agencies. There's a base and a plus and a minus each year, and that's given to the academic units, the colleges, the system campuses, extension, and so forth. So in those units, those academic units, they have 100% of the revenue of the institution. That means they use that to pay their direct costs for faculty, supplies, travel, et cetera. And then they also use it to pay for all the overhead costs. All of our support functions, our salaries, the folks sitting at the table, as well as the libraries, our research infrastructure, our technology infrastructure, all of those support budgets are put into one of the cost pools you see on the right of this chart. And they are charged out on an annual basis through different algorithms to each of our academic units. So in the end, the financial reports we run for any given system, campus, or college will show all of their revenue, all of their direct costs, and all of their overhead costs through this model. That is one piece of what I call our three-legged stool of resource and cost allocation. The first and last leg of that stool is our central decision process. So as I mentioned, when we set up the framework, we are making decisions in our budget planning about compensation, how much for student aid, et cetera. Those decisions are made up front. That flows into the framework, which is the second leg of the stool on the left. And the budget model is the third leg of the stool on the right, which helps us translate all of those variables down to a unit level. So the importance of this is to understand that we work with each of the academic units in this process, understanding all of their revenues, all of their activity, their priorities, and how they can help advance university priorities. We put that all together to balance as best we can and make each one of those academic units as successful as we can. And then we add it all up. And I can go into more detail on that if there are questions, but that's a summary of what we go through every year, meeting with all 50 plus units that we have, the academic units and each of the support units.
President Kaler, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And as we conclude our presentation precisely on time, I want to return to our commitment to accountability to you and the people of Minnesota. As you know, part of our current partnership with you and part of your funding of the university is tied to five performance measures. They include graduation rates, the reallocation of administrative costs, and an increase of STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics graduates. And we've worked hard to achieve those goals. And we've achieved all of your goals for us and, in fact, exceeded them. We're very committed to being excellent, transparent, and accountable partners. And in the weeks and months ahead, we look forward to presenting our budget request to you and showing you how this presentation today, our vision, our statewide impact, and our budgeting process align with that request. So again, thank you for this opportunity. I hope we have left adequate time for questions, and my colleagues and I stand ready to reply.
All right. Thank you very much for the presentation. It's been very thorough, but I know we have questions. So I'll start, since we're talking about the budget here, how involved are the other campuses in the budget process? And then how do you allocate to those campuses after the budget is set? Two easy questions.
Mr. Chair, the system campus, each system campus is treated similar to a Twin Cities Academic College in the budget process. And what I mean by that is all of the revenue is attributed there, just like it is for the colleges on the Twin Cities campus. And they have an opportunity to present their needs, desires, priorities through the budget process to central administration and leadership. They technically report directly to the president for budget operations, but we work with them throughout the process to understand all of their needs, and we make recommendations to the president on how to best address their needs. In terms of how we decide how much to give them, it is similar in our budget model. We look at what's happening with their revenues each year, what is their projected change in tuition and so forth, against their incremental changes in cost. And for every unit that we work with, it's the combination of all of those variables that we try to address. So if their revenues were to exceed their incremental costs, then we help them figure out and decide what priority initiatives they should fund with that excess. If they are short, then we figure out how to reallocate internally or use additional state money to provide them additional funding to cover their costs and their initiatives. We are not able to fund everything that every unit wants, as I'm sure you're aware, but we work hard to address the top priorities for each unit.
Okay, thank you. Representative Omar, I think you're first. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you all for the wonderful presentation. I just had a couple of questions. The first question that I had has to do with the percentage of student graduation without debt. Can you, or someone, elaborate a little bit more of why do we think that is happening? What's the variability in these particular campuses that is causing for one campus to have higher number of students graduating without a debt and some of them low?
President Kaler.
Sure, Chair Nornes, Representative Omar, welcome. We've not yet had a chance to meet and chat, so congratulations on your election.
Thank you.
I wish I had a really good answer for that, because I don't. I think it reflects a combination of a variety of things. I think it reflects the obviously the financial capacity of the family. It can affect the period of time that the student is in school. So the four-year graduation rates on the other campuses are not as high as they are on the Twin Cities campus. And so those students have to stay longer. That incurs an additional tuition payment. But beyond that, we haven't had a chance yet to drill down to root causes. But again, we feel strongly that by investments we've made in improving graduation rates, we ultimately obviously reduce the amount of tuition that a student needs to pay the university, and that should provide opportunities to avoid debt.
Representative Omar.
Thank you, Chair. And then the other, my second question is, as you know, the Twin Cities campus is literally in my backyard. It's in my district. And a lot of my siblings are graduates of the U, and most of the young people who are responsible for my election come from the U. And so I am very much immersed in discussions about the U of M quite often. And so one of the young people that came to visit me recently was inquiring about this idea that the U of M and a lot of the alums are very proud of the rigor, the academic rigor of the U. And he was wondering if there is any work that is being done to bring up the standing of the medical school. I know that it's fallen in ranking, and so I just wanted to know if you can give us some information about that.
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Representative Murray, absolutely. It is one of my highest priorities at the university, and it's a endeavor that the governor has taken significant interest in. He piloted or helped fund medical discovery teams, $30 million in ongoing money that we are using to recruit top flight researchers who will bring with them a cadre of colleagues as well as substantial external research money. Those are in the process of being filled. That will energize new research initiatives in the School of Medicine. We also have the Biomedical Discovery District, so we have terrific space for that research to be carried out. But we have critical needs in the education space, and so I would be remiss to not take this opportunity to advocate for the medical education building that is in the governor's bonding bill. As you know, there was not a bonding bill last year. That's critically necessary for us to improve our medical instruction. But at the end of the day, the reputation is driven largely by the research enterprise, and so we're investing in bringing researchers to the U that will amplify our investment in them and move us up those NIH rankings.
Representative, that's it?
No, one more.
Okay, Representative Omar, go ahead.
I often don't have this many questions, but like I said, the U is dear to my heart, so I just wanted to get some questions because I know that a lot of my constituents would have questions for me, and they would be disappointed if I didn't ask these questions. And so my, I think, last question, hopefully the other questions I have, some of my other colleagues will ask, is I am excited to hear that what has been asked of you, you feel confident that you have accomplished and have exceeded. And I know that reallocation rates were one of the commitments that you had. And so I know that administrative cost often comes up in discussions about the U of M. And so I am interested in knowing that, interested in hearing your answer to how many of the administrative staff that exist within the reallocation that you have talked about of personnel, how many of them were in upper management?
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Madam Moore, we'll get back to you with a detailed list, but off the top of my head, when Robert Jones left the university to go to the University of Albany, he was a senior vice president. I did not replace him, and nor the particular office for the system campuses. I took responsibility for the chancellor's reporting directly to me. We replaced some of what that office did, but at a much lower level. So that's one. We have moved government relations, university relations, and other activities to a more decentralized way that I'm going to bring back together, but we'll do that with no increased headcount. So we've leaned into the problem pretty heavily, and I do not want to sound defensive, because I'm not. I'm proud of what we have done, but it is a $3.6 billion enterprise, and in fact, it does require a management structure to execute on its mission. And I believe if you lined us up against similar institutions, we are not overweight.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you.
Thank you. Representative Schultz, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I have a few questions. Could you go to page 5? I don't know what slide number it is. It's the graduation rates. And can you just try to explain to me why graduation rates differ across campuses and why UMD's rate is so low for your graduation rate?
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, I can try. My answer will be similar to the one I gave previously. Yeah, there you go. So part of it is the student's ability to find a major early on and move through it efficiently. That's a reason that, for example, at Duluth, we've made an investment in retention and advisement so that students can identify a path to success more quickly. Some of it may be economic, that a student may need to stop out for a semester or a year in order to afford to come back to school. That has a serious impact on four-year graduation rates. There are transfer opportunities for students from some of the system campuses to go elsewhere. Those students then don't graduate from the university. But again, if you compare the Duluth four-year to six-year graduation rate, it's a dramatic jump, 39% to 66.5%. So that does tell me that they're just taking a little bit longer, but ultimately getting through at a rate that's not perhaps unexpected.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I guess I would like to have UMD follow up at some point, and I'd like to know how they're addressing it, the problem. But could it, their retention rate is really high. After the first year, it's 82%, which is on the next slide. Do you think the poor graduation rate maybe has something to do with, are those students need to work to pay tuition, or have we reduced the admission requirements, and we have students that might not be as prepared, and so they're dropping out, not graduating?
President Kaler.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, I can speculate on that for you, but I think that the empirical observation is that they're graduating in 6 years, which in 5 or 6 years instead of four, which suggests either a financial or a programmatic issue that probably will be anecdotal, probably will vary from student to student. But we can have the UMD folks look a little more carefully at that and be back with you.
Yes, I'd like them to present at some time, or you bring that data back, and let us know who's responsible for addressing improvement in the graduation and retention rates across the various campuses, and how they're trying to figure out what's causing it and how they're going to rectify it. And then on slide 18, the graphic there has the different units, with UMD being one unit. And it looks like UMD is very reliant on tuition, and their fees, sales, are large. Do you guys know what is in the category fees, sales for UMD? Is that different from the other units?
Yes,
Chair Nornis.
Coniston.
Yep, Representative. That is, in the case of the system campuses, what's also in the fees and sales category would be the auxiliaries. That would be the food service, housing, bookstores, parking, and so forth. That's why that is a little bit higher than it would be at some of the Twin Cities campuses. That is the primary difference between these units. The system campuses have those auxiliary businesses included within them.
So we, Mr. Chair, Schultz. So we include that in our revenue. So we're getting that additional revenue that something like this College of Liberal Arts does not get at the Twin Cities campus. So comparing the College of Liberal Arts to the UMD campus gets a little bit more complicated.
Ms. Coniston.
Yes, Chair Nornis, Representative. It would be more complicated from that perspective. What we were trying to show here is simply the diversity of revenues that we deal with on each for each unit. But yes, if you're comparing them, yes, you'd have to know that.
Okay, one more question.
Representative Schultz.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Could we see that chart by the percent and per student on state share versus tuition to make it easier to interpret? And then my last question is, UMD gets a very small share per student from of state funds, and we make that up, I believe, in tuition and these fees and sales. And I'm just wondering, has the university put any thought in maybe or the regents about if we can continue to subsidize the campus of Morris, for instance, and does that, is that in any way jeopardizing our investments in campuses like UMD? And related to that, like if Morris wasn't part of the system, could it sustain itself financially? And if UMD wasn't part of the system, could it sustain itself financially?
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Representative Schultz, those are interesting questions. So let me just give you some reaction off the top of my head. I don't think any of the system campuses could, quote unquote, survive without state support. They're state institutions. They would then become private institutions, and their tuition and fee structure would have to change pretty dramatically to continue to exist. So they would be fundamentally different. When you look at, and that's true for all of them, I do think that the current system has, as structured, is sustainable, to answer more broadly your first question. But we are in the process of developing a system-wide strategic plan that will enable us to be guided to perhaps more robust answers to that question. The final point I would make on this particular slide is the variances in the sizes of the various bars. I happen to be colorblind, which my colleagues enjoy a great deal on a slide like this. But if you notice the ratio of the state support to tuition, for example, at the Carlson School, that's a very low amount of state support and high tuition. In public health, low state support, and this is grant and very highly grant supported. So one size definitely does not fit all as we look at the campuses and units at the University of Minnesota.
Representative Pawlowski, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to go to page 14 to the second slide where we're talking about resident undergraduate tuition rate. And you use the phrase that the university showed restraint in not increasing tuition. Can you tell me the impact that the state funding had on freezing tuition on the university's restraint?
Mr. Chair, Representative Pawlowski, I was actually going to get to that point myself, and I apologize for the fact that we did not explicitly say that the reason we were able to hold tuition flat in 2013 and 14 was because we had a great partnership with this committee, with the legislature, and with the governor that enabled our state appropriation to be robust enough for us to be able to do that, and I'm grateful for that.
Now, Mr. Chair, President Kaler, I recall that we made record investments in higher education over 13 and 14, so the university could display that marvelous restraint in freezing tuition.
Mr. Chair.
You don't need to answer the question.
Right, thank you.
I also recall that in the House bill in 2013, we had language that would have required the university to have frozen tuition, and we lost in conference committee. Do you recall the used testimony on the House language in the 2013 bill on the requirement to have you freeze tuition, even though we were paying for it?
President Kaler.
Chair Nornes, Representative Pulaski. I suspect you may have a better memory of this than I do, but the history of appropriations to the university because of our constitutional autonomy is that the request is made, but I pledge that we would freeze tuition if those dollars arrived, and I believe I kept my word.
Mr. Chair, President Kaler, you did keep your word, and even though we had the legislative auditor help us craft the language that would have required the U and that we had hoped would have gotten around the extra constitutionality, we were still threatened with a lawsuit if the language was kept in and therefore did not get the votes on the Senate side. But I'd like to go to the last page. You don't need to respond to that. I want to go to the last page. The legislative performance measures that you've met, can you tell me if the University of Minnesota has never met a legislative performance measure and therefore lost money?
President Kaler.
Chair Nornes, Representative Pulaski, no.
Chair, Pulaski. President Kaler, neither can I, and I chaired in 97 to 98 and in 13 and 14. I bring it up because I think the legislative performance measures are sort of a trick that are imposed that they always meet, and then they get to say, well, we met them, and we really worked hard. I recall one particular bill where they had to meet 4 out of 5. Miraculously, they met 4 out of 5 and didn't meet the 5th, but still got the money. So I think whatever bar you set, they're going to meet it, and they're going to get the money. So let's be a little cautious on performance measures. They seem to always meet them. I have another question, and this is a little historic one. In 2015 and 2016, can you refresh the committee on the budget request of the University of Minnesota and then what the University of Minnesota actually got from the legislature for that budget request in 2015 and 2016? I can simplify the question if you need to.
President Chair Nornes, Representative Pulaski, I would appreciate a simpler version of that question.
I would say the simpler version is you did not get your budget request, and you didn't get it by a chunk. And I'm not going to go into specifics now, but we will later. So here's my simpler version of the question. Can you tell me that you didn't get your budget request in 2015 and 2016, and what the consequence was of not getting it? There must have been a consequence, and certainly that we should be able to articulate.
Those led to tuition increases in FY 15 and 16. 16 and 17, thank you.
And Mr. Chair, President Kaler, does your current budget request then reflect the inadequacy of the budget of 15 and 16 in the budget that's currently before the legislature?
Chair Nornes, Representative Pulaski, I would give a little more complex answer to that question than the yes or no that you might want. I think the budget that process that we've gone through that Ms. Ponison has outlined reflects the pressure, the equilibrium of needs and expenditures and resources that we're requesting. It in some sense represents the integral of the budget decisions that have been made made for decades. I don't think it's fair to equate the budget request that we're bringing is reflecting a particular action in a particular time.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, President Kaler, I'm sympathetic to that, but I'm also sympathetic to this, that unless higher education, including the University of Minnesota, can show a consequence to not getting these requests, the requests then have to be characterized as wants and not needs. That's a simplistic overview, but the totality of what you're not getting has to be somehow articulated to this committee and to the people of Minnesota, or it is just a want. And I hope it isn't a want. I hope it is a need, and the need is the escalation of tuition, the escalation of debt. We are a record state in student debt. And that the need has to be demonstrated over a period of time. And we've had this discussion before with presentations of higher education. that we have to have a continuum. And the continuum is, if these budgets work, then they work together, and they work over a continuum of time. I'm not going to go any further today, Mr. Chair, because we're going to hopefully go deeper into the budgets. But that has to be demonstrated, I think, to this committee and to the people of Minnesota, if you expect to get an investment commensurate with your budget request.
All right. Move on to another, unless you have a response, but you don't need one.
Thank you, Representative Mr. Chair. Breyer.
I'm not going to follow that. I'll withdraw my question.
Oh, okay. All right. Representative Leon, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm wondering, I have a couple different issues I'd like to ask about, and whoever's able to best field it. But I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about how enrollment projections fit into your, you know, putting together your budget framework.
President Kaler.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, Mr. Representative, absolutely. We have a comprehensive long-range financial plan that we would be delighted to present to you. It's even more detailed than the presentation we gave to you today. And in that plan, we factor in several, we can factor in several scenarios for growth. Right now, considering the built infrastructure that we have, we are not forecasting substantial growth in any areas nor on any of our campuses, with the exception of the Duluth campus, where we believe there is capacity. We have a challenge around a particular area that's a component of our student success request for this year's budget, which is in the area of computer science and engineering, where we have a great surplus of qualified students. We have a demand from industry for students, for graduates in that field, and we don't have the capacity either in space or faculty to produce that. But it's pockets of growth where we've identified opportunities that we do not charge, do not envision an across the board growth in the near future.
Layton?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And are you finding those pockets of growth, enrollment growth, is that happening in all the campuses, or is it kind of spread out?
Mr. Chair, Mr. Representative, it is most intense in the areas of science, technology, engineering, mathematics, which is significant on the Twin Cities campus and on the Duluth campus. It is particularly intense in Morris, because a large fraction, I believe 40%+ of the Morris students have a biology or bioscience major of one sort or another. There certainly are also demands in some of the business fields, also affecting most significantly the Twin Cities and the Duluth campuses.
Representative Leon.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And just for a little bit of a historical context, I don't know, I mean, not going back too far, but have your enrollment projections been pretty close to what you've realized when that time comes?
Mr. Chair, Mr. Representative, we have a almost spooky ability in our enrollment and undergraduate recruitment process to hit our numbers with a great deal of precision. And Vice Provost McMaster is here, and he's mad that I've now jinxed him by testifying to that effect in front of the legislature. But we have very good people who bring in classes for each of the colleges and programs very close to what we plan to get.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. That's good to hear. Going to another issue I'd like to ask about your reallocations. I see here how much that is and where it's coming from, but do you have any information about where that's going? Is it new programming, existing programming, based on demand of, I don't know, some of those enrollment pockets?
President Kaler.
Chair Nornes, Mr. Representative, absolutely. So we are sometimes asked, well, if you've saved this money, why don't you use that money to either reduce tuition or to reduce the amount of money we ask from the state? And what Ms. Tonneson attempted to introduce to review, and I think did nicely, is that money was used to avoid the need to raise tuition or to ask for increased state support, but to invest in a higher priority at the university. And sometimes it is exactly those pockets. We've made investments in Duluth in order to recruit and to start up programs that we think long-term will be sustainable because of student demand. That's what we do. and it's our job, and we work on it every day, to take the dollars that we have and when possible and appropriate, move them to higher value uses. That's what we do with reallocations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. President Kaler, I do appreciate that. I just wanted a little more specifics than what was illustrated in this presentation. So thank you.
Sure, Mr. Chair and Mr. Representative, we have a detailed list that we can get to you, and we can have a conversation about what that looks like.
All right. Next, Representative Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. President Kaler, something I hear a lot about constituents is student fees, especially at the Twin Cities campus. And I'd like to dig into that a little bit on page 15. It's the first slide. You know, I hear about it from constituents, and I also am an alum of the university, and I experienced it. So I'm wondering who appoints the members of the Student Services Fees Committee?
And
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Representative Christensen, good to see you. I fortunately have brought my provost, and she can answer that question, I believe.
Provost Hanson.
Thank you, Chair and Representative. We in the last year have been engaged in a very robust process of reviewing all student fees, and the students have been involved in that process, and we expect to be reducing student fees. In many cases, this is a contentious process because every student group wants to have its activities funded, at least in part, and there are good reasons to have many of the activities that these students use student fees for, but we realize this is a burden on all students, and so there's been a cooperative but very robust process, and a new fee structure is going into place in the next fiscal year.
Representative Christensen.
Madam Chair, Ms. Hanson, so could you explain a little bit about what the new process will be and how it differs from the old process?
Well, in many ways, the process has remained the same with representatives from our budget staff and with student representatives engaging in review of requests from student groups for student fee support. But and if that's just the part I'm talking about, just those sort of student fees. But there was a very firm charge in this last year as they've been reviewing these fees to keep the fees down and to eliminate them in some cases. And the discussion about this is not really over. We're looking for a new way, for example, to assist and remove from the student fee process the assistance that sometimes supported some of our students who have children with daycare needs. Those are going to be moved out of that student fee process so that you know, all students aren't paying that, but we're going to be looking for other ways of assisting our students who have those kinds of parental needs. So it's both a matter of looking at other ways of serving our students, but also making sure that all student groups recognize the burden it puts on all other students if some of their activities are funded. And so we're just asking everybody to tighten their belts. And then it's a collaborative process on deciding how that works.
Representative Christensen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Hanson, how is it decided what students are members of the Student Services Fees Committee?
Ms. Hanson.
Actually, the chair and representative, our student government folks are on there. I'm not sure. I actually need the Vice Provost for Student Affairs, who manages that process, to tell me who else is there. Although I know students of all sorts can testify at the hearings that they have.
Okay.
Senator Christensen.
So I guess I'm just a little, because that's how it worked when I was a student at the university, was the student association, the student government, appointed the members, the student members of the Student Services Fees Committee, and the Minnesota Student Association also receives its allocation from the Student Services Fees Committee. So are you concerned at all that the organization that's choosing the student members, which are a majority of the committee, is also receiving their budget from that committee?
Ms. Hanson?
We are, but that's also another reason why we have people from the Budget Office and from the Office of Student Affairs monitoring this process, and they actually took a very strong hand in it this year as this new a model was being put forward to lower the overall costs.
Follow up?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. I've also heard from students and constituents concerns about some issues of bias in the allocation process towards liberally aligned student groups. One of the examples that was given to me was a liberal-leaning student newspaper, just looking to make sure I get my numbers right, received over 5.5 times the money that a conservative-leaning newspaper student group, both student groups, received. And I think this raises some concerns about whether the university is in compliance with the principle of viewpoint neutrality as established in Board of Regents of the University of Wisconsin versus Southworth. And I'm just wondering if you're confident that the university is in full compliance with the viewpoint neutrality principle.
Provost Hanson.
Chair and Representative, I would like to check on exactly the cases that you mentioned, because, you know, I don't know what newspapers you're referring to. I mean, you know, sort of think of the main student newspapers, the Minnesota Daily, and that doesn't have a particular bias one way or another. So I think you must be basing this on the on some kinds of examples, and I'd be happy to check into the examples that you may have to hand and get back to you on that.
And thank you. And I was reading through the budget, the 16-17 budget, and I was curious about the allocation to the student service fees event grant, $100,000. I was just curious what that was.
The event budget?
Mr. Hanson.
Yeah, it's listed as the, let me pull it up here exactly, I can read it. $100,000 to the Student Service Fees Event Grant.
What?
It is on 177 of 276.
We'll have to get back to you on that.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, we'll get you an answer on that question.
My guess is that would be a set of events. It's very, I can't imagine that's one event, but we'll get back with you with details.
Christensen?
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ms. Hanson, I was curious about what that was. It sounded like quite the event. I just like to, you know, kind of express and get on the record, you know, that I'm concerned about students having to pay, you know, in 16-17, $864.36 a year in student service fee, which is a lot of money to people. And I think it's disproportionately helping hurting students that, you know, maybe don't come from the most privileged backgrounds and have to work a lot of hours trying to reduce their student loan burden. And, you know, I just did the math, you know, working for a normal wage, it would take 91 hours just to pay for the student service fees. And I'm concerned that these students don't have time to take advantage of the things that the student service fees, the student groups, and those sorts of things that it's going towards, because they have to work so many hours to just to pay this student service fee. And in a time of rising costs, I want the university to be mindful, and it sounds like you are taking steps in that direction, and I'm happy about that, and I hope that we can continue in the direction of trying to reduce that. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Representative Albright.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. President Kaler, thank you for your overview. I certainly appreciate the communication that you and your staff have provided me over the course of the last couple of weeks. I wanted to focus much of my attention on maybe a different aspect of the university and its, I think, profound effect on the state of Minnesota. And I'll start with just kind of reviewing with you the mission statement that you prefaced with in terms of a couple of comments that are in your mission statement. The first one would be search for truth. Now, that could mean a lot of things to a lot of people, but for the context of my line of questioning, I'll use the comment research. Search for truth, scientific search, basic research, the search for discovery. And in your ending statement here under mission. It's the application of this knowledge to benefit the people of the state, the nation, and the world. And that is a land-grant institution that is absolutely what you're called to do. And so I'm hoping that you can give me a couple of examples in terms of how that's being accomplished, some success stories that you might share with the committee.
President McKeever.
Mr. Chair, Representative Albright, let me start from a historical point of view. The pacemaker was invented at the University of Minnesota. It was moved to the commercial space, was the foundational device for Medtronic, and has benefited probably tens of, if not hundreds of millions of people around the world, and saved and extended many lives. So that's a classic example we talk about in translating the medical discovery, the construction of the device, importantly the construction of the company, and the delivery of benefit to mankind. And we did that last year with 17 or 18 startup companies, where they similarly find a device or find a drug that treats a disease and then translates that through the commercial pipeline to benefit the people of the state. We have a walk of discovery that I go on most days from my building to the McNamara Alumni Center, and there are panels that illustrate those discoveries along the way. It's a powerful part of what we do, and we do it well.
Mr. Chair, President Kaler, and we always hark back to the times of Medtronic and Dr. Najarian and others with open heart surgery and the kidney transplants and liver transplants. And I'm wondering if you can expound a little bit on the research that produced those 17 startups last year, and if there are a couple that come to mind that might be highlighted.
Sure. So, Chair, Representative Albright, we have a company called Flipgrid. And what they have done is create software that enables communities to communicate with each other through short videos. It's obviously competitive in the social media space, but that company is very well founded by a local venture capitalist who has a terrific history. It's come out of the College of Education and Human Development, and it's a way to improve teaching and communication, and it's ripe and off to the races. We have research activities around diabetes treatment. We have water treatment inventions. I'm sorry, I'm not better prepared or more articulate to give you some specific, more recent examples, but we can get you some there in person.
Mr. Chair, President Kaler, to continue on that. You note in the slide that we are ranked eighth in research as a university, U.S.-based, in terms of expenditures. I'm just wondering where that places us, or would place us, say, the last 3, 5, and 10 years. Where's the trend line for that ranking been?
Mr. Chair, Representative Albright, off the top of my head, I would say that we have been notionally in about that same place, 8, 9, 10, over the past 5 to 10 years. I'm not sure that we've gone to 11th, and I'm not sure that we've gone to 7th. The reason for that is that if you look at the rank order of schools and the amount of money that we do, it's a steep curve. So the amount of money it takes to move up one notch may be an increase of 5% or so of your research total. And so those are big jumps, and schools tend to stay relatively the same rank. The exception to that, I will say, is Wisconsin, who has dropped a couple of ranks in the past few years as their higher ed community has been a little bit of turmoil.
All right.
Mr. Chair, President Kaler, you know, we talk often about basic research moving to translational research and then the commercialization of that. And so in that same slide, we talk about 100 startups over the past decade from faculty research. And I know it in your budget, and I won't delve into that. I think we'll cover that in the next committee. So I'll just refrain from that and go on this, but I do note that there is a patent attorney that is cited in the budget for about $260,000. And not that I'm going to ask about, you know, whether or not there is virtue in hiring another attorney. sorry for everyone in the room. But to the extent that I often hear about the reticence and or the lack of fluidity in terms of commercialization for the people that have actually done the work. And I think, you know, we ought to partner with those in a much stronger fashion to say, look, if you're bringing the intellectual blood, sweat, and tears to the project, we're supportive of the research, but at some point, you've got to let the birds in the nest fly, if you will. And so to the extent that we hold them back, I'm just wondering whether or not you have any concerns, or maybe Mr. Burnett can speak to, you know, the legal structure in terms of ownership of those patents, the intellectual property, and how you're moving towards expediting those birds leaving the nest to blossom in our state.
President Kaler.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, Representative Albright, we have an Office of Technology Commercialization that's led by a experienced industry veteran. And we're actually pretty good at this. I mean, for us to generate the trajectory that you see on this slide, not every university is capable of doing that. And the Office of Technology Commercialization is very mindful and planful in what we call a stage gate process, to bring in a faculty member as an idea, says, I think this is commercializable, and then to lead them with engagement with experienced entrepreneurs to getting to where a company could start. And a parallel process with that is the development of the protection of the intellectual property. And I have 10 U.S. patents myself, and I will testify that it is far better to have a skilled in-house legal counsel to help you get to specific claims and language that will ultimately withstand scrutiny and that will lead to a patent. At a far lower cost than it is to contract with a specialty one-off patent firm in town. Now, there are times in which the technology that we're interested in developing is so specialized that, in fact, we do have to bring in somebody who has particular expertise in that little bit of the intellectual property space. But we're mindful of this, and we will occasionally reach a point in which the OTC decision will be, you know what, this is going to take a lot more work, and it may ultimately not be an invention. And we'll release that intellectual property back to the inventor, and if that inventor wants to run with it on his own, he's free to do that. But the university does own the intellectual property, and we work hard with faculty members who want to develop that. And I would finish with the observation that not all faculty members have any interest in doing that whatsoever. They're perfectly happy to make their contributions to the scientific or medical literature and let others take that and build upon it. And that's okay, too.
All right. Mr. Chair and President, again, to that point on the slide where we're talking about the startups over the past decade, and you highlight $219 million in aggregate investment capital raised over that period of time. And I'm just wondering if that also then, if you could identify, is that just capital raised for the advancement of research or the commercialization? And again, you know, is that done on the inventor's timeline, or is that done in cooperation with the University of Minnesota? And we often hear of other universities where it seems that the rapidity or the acceleration of startups going to commercialization is much faster than that we might hear from the University of Minnesota. And so to a peer-to-peer, you know, how do you compare, and if there's an apples-to-apples comparison, that would be the fairest, but, you know, conjecture aside, you know, we've got two coasts that seem to be nipping at our heels in certain areas and certain industries. And how do we compete in that venue without availing those folks of a little more leash on the rope, if you will.
Slack on the leash, yeah.
Yes, you got my drift.
Mr. Chair, Representative Albright, it's a great question, and it goes to the need to continue to build the collaborative and creative entrepreneurial culture in the Twin Cities. It is true that it is easier to commercialize in Silicon Valley, the Boston Route 128 area, and to a lesser degree, but still better than us, in the Research Triangle in North Carolina. And that's because they have an ecosystem of experienced CEOs, CFOs, angel investors who will with rapidity, as you like to say, invest in and advance those forward. We have to provide a lot of that structure here at the university because there's not yet that kind of culture in the Twin Cities. I think it's getting better. I know it's getting better. I know the Medical Alley companies are investing in this, and I know that as we improve, we will just naturally generate a next generation of folks who are experienced entrepreneurs and can move these companies forward. So I think we're on an upward cycle here, but we are not at the level of the three places in the country that I mentioned.
President
right.
Kaler, just going over the economic impact, kind of leading into what you were just discussing in terms of, there's a couple statements here, and not that I don't believe you, but I'm just looking for some additional data in terms of to reinforce what's being said here. The U generates $8.6 billion a year in economic impact. That's a big number. And to the extent in terms of how do we arrive at that in terms of a pie chart that generates it from research, grants, from business development, how do we arrive at that number?
Chair Nornes, Representative Albright, we used a third party to develop that for us, and so we actually have a document that supports that with facts. This was done in 2011, shortly before I arrived here, so it's actually a pretty dated number, and I would suspect the number now is substantially bigger than this, but the process of generating it correctly is not inexpensive, and so I've been reluctant to reinvest in a new in an update of that. Perhaps it's time to do that, but we can get you the backup information for this.
And Mr. Chair and President, right. That same slide, then, right. It mentions that the U alumni have founded nearly 10,000 companies in Minnesota. I'd certainly appreciate the time frame under which that's a lot of companies.
And that's probably all time.
Members, we're going to stay here till 5 o'clock, just so you know, and I've got about five more questioners. So.
With that in mind, I'll defer to the rest of the committee.
Okay. Bernardi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate the opportunity to ask a question for keeping us a little bit later. I wanted to ask about the performance measures that you have here. Are these something that you provided us because you follow these as an organization, or it's something to be more transparent to the public? And the reason why I ask is because I find it helpful. And one of the things I wanted to drill down on this one, and just briefly, because I have a couple more questions, is the inclusive success. And that was one of students of color with a favorable sense of belonging on campus. And that has gone down, it stayed about the same, or has gone down over 4 years. So what are you guys doing about that one? And if you could just briefly explain this to me in like 2 minutes, because I would like to move on to another quick question.
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Madam Representative, these are the results of a so-called CERO survey, which we administer to all students. And you're right, that it is, I would say, fluctuated, dropped a little bit. And it does represent an enormous challenge for the university. We are at about, our entering class is 22.3% students of color, but we have challenges in a majority white university to provide opportunities for students of color to truly feel at home, to truly feel welcome, and to truly feel they belong. It's a challenge. We have programs in place to work on it, and we plan to be better.
Bernardi?
Okay, and then this progress report on your measures, a gold and maroon measures, is this something that you use internally to make decisions at the University of Minnesota, and you're sharing it with us? Is that the purpose of this?
Mr. Chair, Madam Representative, yes. The Board of Regents embraced the idea of developing a progress card, as did I. It's a very, I'm glad you find it useful. I do, too, to have these little bit of the heartbeat and the pulse of the institution. And we spent some time with the board developing what these measures are to be sure that they are actually important and relevant, and we have the two classes, the gold measures that could be more explicitly measured and monitored, and the maroon measures that in some sense are a little bit more qualitative or perhaps not as critically important.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Chair, I have my other question for the president is regarding the mission. And I'm assuming that this mission, okay, I'll ask you that question at the end. But this mission talks about diverse community. It talks about benefiting the people of the state. And I want to know how much you and your organization, the university, as well as the regents, look at the University of Minnesota with an equity lens. Minnesota has some of the biggest disparities in the country, if not the biggest. And we can become an amazing state if we can close those disparity gaps, and our prosperity would be amazing for everyone's lives and not just some in Minnesota. What role does the University of Minnesota play in looking on that big issue in Minnesota, not only through in students, but also helping Minnesota solve this challenging issue?
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Madam Representative, I worry about equity all of the time in a variety of dimensions at the university. You may know that I was a founding co-chair of Generation Next, which is a very strong program in the community to help close the education and opportunity gaps, achievement and opportunity gaps between students of color and white students. And the university's research, if you ask Generation Next, they would tell you is absolutely central to doing this. We're focused on reading preparation. We have a focus on the eighth grade around math preparation. And we have a program which we call Go for Math, which we're piloting in the Minneapolis Public Schools right now to help students be math ready. So when you look at what we do for the Principals Academy, you look at what we do with the Terry program in teacher education, you look at what we do in educational psychology curriculum, we are all over this problem, and in many cases we're in leadership roles as we move forward. We've identified faculty members who have lead responsibilities for this. We're all in tackling this problem, and in fact we have an element around it in our budget.
And then, Mr. Chair, one final question to follow up on the UMD conversation. I was looking at the charts here, and I see that the University of Minnesota falls right smack in the middle of the Big Ten with their tuition. If you add their, and even if you add their fees, they're right there as well. How is that appropriate for a regional university to be in the middle of the cost of the Big Ten Conference?
President Kaler.
It's on page 15.
Mr. Chair, Madam Representative, if my colleague would go the other way.
Oh, sorry.
15, she said.
And then, Mr. Chair, they're looking for that, it's difficult for, I would think it would be difficult for the University of Minnesota to be competing with their peers when their tuition is, well, at UMD, excuse me.
The University of Minnesota Twin Cities is in the midpoint on this slide. This is Twin Cities data.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair, can I just clarify?
Yes.
If you go to I pulled it off from another graph that you provided, and I inserted the tuition number and the tuition and fee number, I know as well, is $12,800. If you put it in there, they are smack in the middle.
That, Mr. Chair, Madam Representative, that's a fair point. And we worry about where Duluth is in terms of a price point compared to the institutions with which they compete for students, which is a reason why we increased our investment in Duluth so that their tuition would not have to increase. And we can start to put them where they need to be in the midpoint of the peers they compete with. That's a valid concern.
Okay. Thank you.
Hopefully the next question is going to be brief, but do the best you can. Representative Whalen, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, President Kaler, and others for your testimony and presenting the budget to us. I have a few questions, but in the interest of time, I'll just keep it to brief. And this is kind of one of the ones you had alluded to earlier. And I completely appreciate the complexity of the budget being $3.6 billion. It's a lot. So there's a lot of information here, but this was from a Star Tribune article earlier, and I was just wondering if you could comment on it. Or President Kaler, this is a quote from you that you wanted to assure members of the legislature that no state funds or tuition dollars will be used to cover the cost of the coaching transition. And said that other, pardon me, other resources would be used for that. Now, it seems to me that the university oftentimes has wanted the least amount of restriction as possible on state funds, but then if there's a controversial issue, whatever the topic is, in this case athletics, you assure us that state funds won't be used for that, but then this article goes on, and I just think it's a good way to phrase it. Don't worry, we're not spending your money on X, we're using this other pool of money, but money is fungible. So if you weren't using it on the athletic department for buyouts, you could spend it on insert research, student success, student affordability, things of that nature. So I understand we have limited time, and I'm hoping we can continue the conversation, but just wondering if you could briefly comment.
President, Mr. Chair, Representative Whalen, sure. What we do, which we have backup slides that we're not going to be able to find in time, expenditures in Gopher athletics and football and men's basketball, those expenditures are substantially lower than the revenue we receive from the Big Ten Network, leave alone ticket sales and other revenue sources. So I believe it is fair to say that the football program expenses are covered by those funds. Now, of course, those funds are also used in other parts of the athletic department, and it will require budgeting work for us to be able to land the athletics budget on time, and that may require a couple of years of budget adjustment, so we may need to make a loan to athletics that's paid back over time. But I think it's very legitimate to be able to isolate the costs associated with the coaching transition and a sum total of that activity that's less than what we receive from the Big Ten. I believe I can legitimately say that we're not using state dollars.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, President Kaler, for that response. I do have some follow-up questions that I'd like to ask, but in the interest of time, I'm wondering maybe if it would be better to have an offline conversation and continue delving into the budget. I do echo some of the concerns of my fellow committee members that for a lot of the asks and a lot of the times that, or just the past 2 years when we've been chatting, it seems that there's sometimes a disconnect on making the need apparent, because a lot of the things that I'm looking at for where we're looking to invest, they could be great, but I'd love clarification on them. And also, there seems to be less, and throughout all of this, less emphasis on actually holding or decreasing student tuition. And I just see a lot of different areas for investing in adding faculty and adding different programs, which again could be wonderful, but I just want to make sure we're on the same page and understanding the need of the university for asking for increased funds.
The university will be back for under the full.
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Indeed, Mr. Chair, it was not our purpose here today to do that, and we will be back fully prepared to talk to the merits of the request that we have.
Okay, Representative Jessup.
Thank you, Mr. Yeah. Chair. President Kaler, question for you, a philosophical one. I'll just one question, and that is, we have two higher ed state public institutions, Minnesota State and the University of Minnesota. You've been at the helm for 6 years. How do you individually, philosophically, kind of look at the objectives of the University of Minnesota relative to the objectives of Minnesota State?
President Kaler.
Mr. Chair, Representative Jessup, that's a great question. And I think we are really blessed, and I think that's the right word, in the state of Minnesota to have a world-class research institution, a very robust network of two-year community colleges and four-year universities, complemented by a wonderful cluster of private higher education institutions. I think the people of Minnesota are incredibly well served by that variety and range of activity. So I think they're very complementary. I think they serve different needs for different people at different stages of their career. It may well make a lot of sense for a student from Mankato to get a four-year degree at Mankato State and decide to come to law school at the University of Minnesota or medical school at the University of Minnesota. So that the pipelines and the accessibility that our small system and Minnesota State's larger system brings to the people of Minnesota from an educational point of view is terrific. But we alone own the public research responsibility, which is enormously important for the economy of the state of Minnesota, the economic prosperity of the state of Minnesota, and we own to a very large degree the professional development, the medical school, the dental school, the pharmacy school, that again are critically trained specialties for the people of Minnesota. So I think it's a wonderfully complementary set of systems that we have here.
Representative Jessup, you hit the last question today, so there's no prize. We all get to leave, I guess. Thank you very much, President Kaler, and
thank
your
you for
staff
your time.
For being here. It's a very excellent presentation, good questions. Thanks to everybody that's in the audience, and we are adjourned.